Maps are incredibly important to us, whether or not you could ace a National Geographic geography bee, since they're literally how we understand the world around us.
I mean, of course, you could actually go to some of these places around the world, but maps are important for that too.
But every map has to make a very specific but a very important choice. How exactly does it need to lie to you? Now, when you think about it, maps, especially 2D maps, are all lying to you in some way. And I don't just mean maps like these, oh god, I think we're going to be sick, but almost all maps need to find a way to lie about what it's showing in order to convey the ideas it's actually trying to convey to you. Now, sure, we all know about the Mercator Projection and how Greenland isn't actually anywhere near the size of Africa, but maps also need to choose what to exclude as well as what to include, because unless you're mapping somewhere like the middle of rural Mongolia, there will be a lot of useful information to include. But including absolutely everything will give the maps so much information that it's impossible to draw any from it in the first place. Transit maps are a very notable example of this, so let's use that as our first example. Let's say you're a clueless tourist trying to get around Berlin. So let's say you're trying to get from Alexanderplatz to Berlin Hauptbahnhof. Now, Berlin being the capital and largest city of Germany is insanely well connected, which is great when you're actually trying to get somewhere, but not necessarily if you want to actually understand how to get there. Berlin has multiple options for transit. First off, you could drive there or take a taxi or something like that, so it would be nice to see the roads, of course. But chances are, you're not going to be driving around Berlin, so perhaps a much more popular option would be to take the S-Bahn or the U-Bahn. In this case though, I'd recommend the S-Bahn, but let's keep the U-Bahn lines on there just for illustration purposes. Additionally, you could also take the tram, since most of this trip would be in former East Berlin. Then of course, there's also the option to take the bus, which Berlin has a lot of, and of course you can also rent a bike, and you know what, let's just show the old course of the Berlin Wall, just for good measure. So this map is pretty crowded and confusing, and in practice, you don't need that much information. The 1 and 2 map suffers hugely from this. Obviously, it's not as bad in places like Washington DC, where the transit system isn't so big, but in places like Berlin or London, oh my god, that's a lot of lines. This is why the tram maps in Berlin are separate from the S and U-Bahn lines, and they only show the tram lines. But the S and U-Bahn lines are still shown, but are faded out. And they're kind of just there so you know where you are in the network. Metro maps around the world also rarely show streets, and not doing so allows them to also play with proportions, which helps make it easier to design and comprehend. My personal favorite slash least favorite example of this was the Max Libro map back in Portland, which makes it look like a trip across all of downtown Portland is about the same length as the entire east side, even though Rose Quarter to Gateway is nearly 100 blocks, and Oak Southwest Third to Providence Park isn't even 10 blocks. Come on, people. However, if downtown Portland were represented accurately on the Max maps, as it is in some cases, there wouldn't be a way to show the map without jam-packing everything into something that didn't even make sense. Really though, metro maps are terrible as walking guides, because they're meant to make you think, okay, so that station leads to that other station in this way, but not in that way. I get it now. Not, oh, okay, so I could just walk directly west from Fortestrasse to Humboldthain and catch the S-Bahn from there, because that's not at all how the neighborhood is shaped. Let's say I wanted to go somewhere further, like if I wanted to fly somewhere. If I wanted to fly to London or Istanbul, everything seems pretty normal, right? Just a normal straight line. Makes sense. Well, what if I wanted to come back to America? Well, all I need to do then is draw a straight direct line to— whoa, why is it curved? You've probably seen this before on airplane maps, but a perfectly straight flight from Berlin to Portland, if it existed, would actually take me up past Iceland and Greenland and down through Western Canada, instead of through the Northern Atlantic and America's heartland, for example. This again has to do with the fact that we're displaying the map as a flat surface. We're seeing the line as a curved line on a flat surface, but really it's a straight line on a curved surface, but flattening the plane doesn't make the line very happy. Also, do notice how the line changes direction as soon as it hits the equator if we were to reroute the flight to somewhere like Sydney. And also notice how it's completely straight from flying directly south to Cape Town. As you've probably heard it said time and time again, there's no way to project a sphere onto a flat plane without some minor distortions. In the case of world maps, some aren't noticeable, while others are frankly nauseating to look at. Oh god, I think I'm gonna be sick. The most famous of these nowadays is the Mercator Projection, which Google Maps is known for using since it's easy to zoom in on, but it also over-exaggerates the furthest northern and southern latitudes, and squishes the equatorial latitudes, which makes Greenland look about the size of Africa, and makes Canada and Russia look even bigger than all of Texas. It also makes Antarctica look like a huge ice wall at the bottom of our planet, which is probably why most Mercator maps just cut off the South Pole, which also puts the equator further down than it should be, and thus makes the southern hemisphere look, for some reason, smaller than the northern hemisphere. But I mean, who even lives down there anyway?
Excuse me?
Wait, Jade from Up and Adam? What are you doing here? I didn't give Australia a speaking role in this video, did I?
No. And last time I checked, there isn't a criminal joke in there either. I was just here to tell everyone that—
Wait, last time you checked? How did you know what I was going to be talking about here?
You shared your script with me, remember? We're collaborating.
Oh yeah, that's right. This video was actually made in tandem with Jade's channel, Up and Adam, who made a video about the four-color map theorem. Definitely check it out after this video is over if you haven't already. Okay, so what about normal, non-distorted globes? Are they still lying to you? Yes. Because maps used to be made almost exclusively by governments, and governments almost always— I mean, there are still more ways that a map might not be accurate that we still have yet to address. Prime example, the borders. And I don't just mean that in the sense that borders are made up lines that can't be seen from space, which itself isn't 100% true. I mean, take India and Pakistan, for example. I mean everyone's favorite topic, disputed territories. Since the two Koreas don't recognize each other as nations, when you ask the government based in Seoul, Korea looks like this, but if you ask the government based in Pyongyang, it looks like this. And there are numerous other examples of these as well, like with Kosovo, China's disputed territories, India's disputed territories, Catalonia, the South China Sea, those islands off of Maine and New Brunswick, South Tyrol, Crimea, that little knob in South Sudan, the Yauzu Strip, Kashmir, and Jammu, and of course, let's not forget about everyone's favorite screaming ground. Then of course, you also get maps that are outdated, misinformed, biased, or even just plain wrong. Of course, statistics and data maps are also very privy to being inaccurate or misleading. One very notable example that I have used is this map of the spread of the Black Death throughout Europe, which apparently seems to state that Poland was completely fine during the plague, and I have said twice before in previous videos that Poland was completely fine during the plague. Q2 seconds of Polish patriotism. However, Poland wasn't completely fine during the plague, it was just less affected than other parts of Europe. The exact same thing happened in Milan. All in all, maps may be lying to you, but in reality, it's actually so that they can be more truthful to you. After all, if you wanted to know what countries are part of NATO, for example, you don't need their capitals, largest cities, major rivers, monuments, railroads, highway systems, forests, etc. So I guess it's not so much a lie, just as it is withholding information. But, I mean, lying makes more and more clickbaity title. You can also get maps that just do away with topographical accuracy, and instead color all the countries in different colors, which can be fun to play around with if you're into math, like what my friend Jade explains on her channel, Up and Adam.
Actually, the problem of how many colors it takes to color in a map was too hard for humans. It was the first proof to be solved by a computer. I've covered the story on my channel, Up and Adam, which you should check out after this.
And even if you're not into math and science, you'll still love her channel. Seriously, she makes amazing videos. Oh, and the cartoons. Don't forget about the cartoons she puts in. Seriously, she put a lot of work into this video, go watch it. As always, thank you for watching this video, and if you enjoyed it, please be sure to give it a like and share it and subscribe to learn something new every Sunday. Oh, and check out Jade's video too. In fact, subscribe to both of our channels. I mean, if you're not subscribed to either of us, let's be honest, what are you even doing with your life? Oh, and also, see you on Sunday.